Look, forget it. The world is full of women, each adequately equipped for your entertainment.
This is one of Howard Hughes' most adventurous productions for RKO. It has all the stylistic hallmarks of a Hughes picture. We're nearing the end of our journey through the life of RKO Radio Pictures, the company that made King Kong, Citizen Kane, Stage Door, Bringing Up Baby, Mister Rogers musicals, The Hunchback of Notre Dame, The Cat People. Now brings you Lily Sansier, the queen of American striptease, in the immortal Son of Sinbad.
How dare you enter here?
I think that's enough of that. So, if you're watching our final episode for more cinematic landmarks and further tales of the motion picture pioneers, I have to disappoint you. For the story I have to tell is, to adopt the idiom of Mr. Hughes' own publicity department, one of money, power, intrigue, and sexual obsession. Not necessarily in that order. When Hughes bought the studio in 1948, he bought a plaything. Maybe he didn't see it that way, but that's how our distinguished cast will describe it. Many of them revealing, as they say, for the very first time in public, some of the more curious aspects of their relationship with the oddest studio boss in the history of the movies. By the time he bought RKO in 1948, the eccentricities of Howard Hughes were well known. The acquisition of RKO was just one more chapter in an already bizarre career. Howard Hughes was famous in America for a succession of daredevil flying escapades and record attempts, for the management of the fabulously wealthy Hughes Tool Company, the making of the first World War epic Hell's Angels, with some of the most lavish flying sequences ever filmed. For the launch of the airline giant TWA, and most recently, the incredible Spruce Goose, a project to build the largest troop and military equipment carrier in the world, but using the engines and wooden airframe construction of an earlier era. Hughes' most recent appearances in public had been at the tests of this doomed monster.
She's cost $25 million, 18 government millions, 7 millions of Hughes's money, and there was a congressional inquiry into the matter.
I put the sweat of my life into this thing. I have my reputation rolled up in it, and I have stated several times that if it's a failure, I'll probably leave this country and never come back, and I mean it.
These tests, now being carried out, were intended to be no more than runs on the surface. Then, as one of our cameramen was filming the scene, Hughes evidently changed his mind and decided on a takeoff. He flew her just above the water for about a mile, and I'll bet that gave the millionaire pilot one of the biggest thrills in a lifetime full of thrilling adventures.
Although a further $5 million was spent on Spruce Goose, she never again took to the air. The following year, Hughes bought RKO.
The protracted negotiations between Mr. Hughes and Mr. Odlum have given rise to many groundless rumors and the circulation of much misinformation. Mr. Hughes has no hungry army of relatives looking for your jobs or substitutes waiting to step into the RKO management. Mr. Hughes has many and wide business interests and much experience in our industry. I believe he will be a valuable and constructive influence in our company.
We were all very impressed and very frightened because I had a reputation for being an interferer and a tinkerer, and he lived up to his reputation. He immediately started changing, for some reason, the ends of every picture that had been made in the studio. He just stopped everything and wanted the end redone. And we started calling him an anal erotic because of this quirk of his.
We went to work on a picture that actually boasted the very first totally new built sets since the war, because they'd been revamping all the sets, but actually for this film they designed totally new sets. And the whole thing was very lively and very pleasant. And we had a rather unique director, John Farrell. Miss Russell was a very strong individual and very good humored when she wasn't cranky. And we made actually a very decent picture. I think it cost about $750,000. And Mr. Hughes looked at it and he set out to make a great picture of it. So a year or two later, and a couple of million dollars later, it came out again. You know, he redid it. I think we remade it probably two more times.
Hughes' obsessive remounting and reshooting of the picture was an attempt to satisfy himself about the effective presentation of Jane Russell. A star new to RKO, though she had been under personal contract to Hughes for 10 years.
4 little miles from San Bernardino, 3 little miles from San Bernardino. My bag was packed and ready. I said to myself, steady, 2 more miles and you're in heaven.
His Kind of Woman was a very pivotal picture. It was the first time that Robert Mitchum was starred with Jane Russell. Hughes was very concerned that this hottest team ever to hit the screen, which is a line that he liked very much, would promote and could make the motion picture successful. The painting that I did, he just enjoyed very, very much. I think only once did he say to me, would you lower the décolletage a little bit, about a half inch here, and move it down to about a quarter of an inch here. But never made any other comment than that. One evening, he spent a half hour on the couch with me in Beverly Hills just discussing the thickness of a shirt. Now, obviously, the thickness of the shirt had to do with a garment that was, in this particular case, on Jane Russell. And he wanted me to understand very clearly how the thickness of the shirt would appear as it was against human flesh. But he was painstaking to make certain that I understood not the thickness of a pocket, he would repeat it over and over again, and then would always ask, "You understand what I mean?" I would say, "Yes, Mr. Hughes, I do." And then he would go over it again, and when you left, it was impressed in your mind exactly what he had in mind to do.
Your clothes were very much part of your being the actress you were at that time.
Yes, and the clothes usually, you know, were strapless, or they couldn't be terribly what I would call chic, or what I might buy myself, but they were, Michael could design beautiful things, but they always had to have, you know, the movie star image or something.
Mr. Hughes involved himself, did he not, in your clothes a great deal?
Drove us absolutely crazy. And he did all this on the telephone with Michael Wolfe. And then poor Michael would have to come and tell me. And then I would disagree and I'd argue and I'd holler and yell, and Michael would have to go back and tell Mr. Hughes yes or no or what, or, and so the argument went on. You know, I'd hate to be in his shoes, but it was fun from where I was.
The only time he ever gave me instructions was always on a picture with Jane Russell. It was a Sunday night, and the phone rang, and they told me, "Mr. Hughes will see me. Where are you?" And I told them where I was, and they started to calculate and add and subtract. And they figured if I left then, it would take me 22 and a half minutes to get to the Samuel Goldwyn studio. And then they said, when I get there, blink my lights. And then the gate man would let me in. And then the car on the lot would blink their lights, follow that car, and that's the way it went. He could have easily had an office at RKO, but he didn't. This time he met me at his office on the Samuel Goldwyn lot. A very, very bare, nothing office, a desk, a chair, an overhead light. And this connected to his own private projection room.
Do you mind if I join?
Seems you have.
Hey, you sing pretty good. I thought I'd buy you a drink.
I'm drinking champagne.
I'm a hit. $18 a bottle.
Champagne's not your drink.
Only on big occasions.
And this isn't?
He had the painting made. He liked it very, very much. And then one day I was told that the brilliant idea had come up, and I asked, what was this about? They said, well, we're going to do something very special. So at the RKO lot, I didn't see this being constructed, but I saw it being moved at 2 o'clock in the morning. And this was to a site at the corner of Fairfax and Wilshire Boulevard, directly across from the May Company. There was a large parking lot there and a restaurant which no longer exists. And they put on that corner a huge gilded frame, like a masterpiece, if you will. This was all framed, gold-leafed, and the center was going to house my painting, 20, 30 times the size of the original, if not 100 times the size. It was enormous. The painting was completed. But while that was going on, people were passing by, and cars were going by, and they were monitoring how many vehicles would pass the corner. Mr. Hughes had an idea that to emphasize the concept of the hottest combination ever to hit the screen, that they would have two or three or four large gas jets throw flames up into the air about 20 or 30 feet high. Now, everybody thought that this was marvelous. And that it would be certainly an exciting event to have this happen. And these gas jets would go up. They would be programmed every so many minutes to flame up. And I was there, and I saw all the gas people coming. All the pipes were being put up, and the tests were being made with short gas jets, and the publicity people were there. And while all of that was going on, a phone call came. It was stop everything. Well, it seemed that there was something on the docket that we were not aware of. It came out in the newspapers later, some kind of dealings with Hughes and the city fathers, and well advised that maybe they would have been very irate that this was going on, and the possibility that those jets going up into the air were prone for accidents for motorists passing by who wouldn't expect that thing to occur. And he just said, I just wanted you to know, he used to call me Zampi. He said, I want you to know, Zampi, that sometimes, he said, things happen where we just have to change plans. So I guess I had a very sad look on my face, you know, so he made a fist and clumped me on the jaw, and he says, you gotta learn to roll with the punches. And I said, yes, Mr. Hughes. It was a very short meeting, but it was his concern that I found very, very moving for me, and that there were other instances like that where he always showed his humanity.
He phoned me actually at the office possibly once during the years we were together. He liked to phone people about 3 o'clock in the morning. The reason for that is this. Mr. Hughes believed in something called natural sleep. And what did that mean? That meant that one kept awake until one grew tired. When one grew tired, one went to sleep. This could be 36 hours, it could be three. It could be on the floor of his office, it could be in his bed. It didn't matter terribly. He liked the nights because it was very quiet. There was another reason for his liking the nights. He was growing hard of hearing, and the nights obviously a little more quiet than the daylight. He used to call me about 3, sometimes 4 in the morning, and the conversation usually began very politely as follows. Sorry to disturb you, Bill. And I'd say, I'm sorry also, Howard, my voice being thick with sleep. And he'd say, you sure you're all right? It doesn't bother you. And I said, thinking my contract, not a bit, not a bit. And then he would tell me a particular project that we would discuss, often on the phone for 20, 30 minutes. Always polite, always well-mannered, and always ended again with an apology for disturbing me. Mr. Hughes was a fascinating man. There are many stories, not all apocryphal. For example, one of them, that he never saw RKO, is absolutely true. He never visited the studio. His own functions in running the studio were either from a little office on a street called Romaine Street, or a similarly small office that he had at a rival studio, the Samuel Goldwyn Studio, where he spent many, 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 many hours learning, for example, to cut and edit film. He wanted to learn what he was doing. He was a man of extraordinary brilliance and of great diligence and of enormous patience, meaning if it took 10 days to do something that anyone else would do in a day, he would do it in 20. But he would master it by the 19th day. He knew precisely what he was doing, why he took 20 days. And it was his money in this particular case. He did what he wished.
Jeff, I had to come back. What else could I do?
You can never help anything, can you? You're like a leaf that the wind blows from one gutter to another.
Hughes also spent vast sums of his money on buying up female talent. From the age of 18, Jane Greer had been under personal contract to Hughes, but she'd escaped the entanglement via a brief marriage to Rudy Valley and then by becoming a contract player at RKO. Now that Hughes had bought the studio, she found herself once again under his control.
Jeff, I've missed you. I've wondered about you and prayed you'd understand. Can you understand?
You prayed, Kathy?
Can't you even feel sorry for me?
I'm not going to try. Let's just leave it where it all is. Get out.
3 days after assuming control of the studio, he sent for me. And I hadn't seen him for years. And now I'm married, happily married. I have a child and so forth. And he as much as said, no, you're not happy. I said, yes, I am, Howard. I'm very happy. And I have a child and I'm, you know, really very happy. No, you're not. You're not happy. Not really happy. Not deep down inside you're not happy. You know, he couldn't understand it. And I said, yes, I am. Well, as long as I own the studio, you won't work. That ought to get you. And I said, it will put an end to my career. He said, yes, I guess it will. I said, then I will just keep having babies, Howard. He said, you'll be paid every week. I said, thank you. And at that time, I was making about $2,500 a week because they had renegotiated the contract. And he meant it. And I was stopped dead in my tracks.
Hughes' delusion that in buying an actress's contract, he actually owned the woman herself, spilled over into his entire social life, which he pursued with the same obsessive energy.
The first time I went to Palm Springs, I was so thrilled to go to the Racquet Club where all the stars were, and oh, they looked so beautiful. Everybody was all dressed so, and it just was very thrilling to me. And sure enough, in came Howard Hughes in the dirty sneakers and the old shirt and all of that. And I was with my husband, I was married, and friends of his that were all in the business. And very shortly, a note was passed to me from the maitre d', and I looked at it, read it, I started to laugh, and I read it out loud to the group. It said, my limousine will be at the back door of your bungalow at midnight, signed Howard Hughes. Well, I was positive that someone of the group was playing a joke on me. And to my amazement, they got very cross with me. They said, stop that. Stop laughing, put that note away, because they could see us, because they were just a table away. And to my utter amazement, they said, well, aren't you going to go? And these are friends of my husband, and I'm sitting there with him. They said, you can handle it. Handle it. There's only one way you handle something like that.
He had bungalows all over Hollywood, houses. He took me to one. And he said, here is a house I want you to have. Ida Lupino told me the same thing. I said, well, I've got a house of my own, thank you. More than that, I've got a husband and a child. And he didn't expect that. He proposed marriage to me several times over the course of 10 years.
Walter Kane called and asked me if he could bring Howard up to the house to talk about my coming to RKO and taking over production. because he had just bought this company. And so I said, of course. So they came up, and they were there for 2 hours, and we waltzed around the subject of running the studio and talked seriously about, I thought we were talking seriously about making pictures. And what I discovered later was that he was romancing my wife, and part of his scenario for her was that he would buy the house from the two of us. And I think he was there only to ostensibly be making an appraisal of what he had agreed to buy.
He was a man who was used to having his way, and so he didn't, and yet, in retrospect, he was also terribly afraid of rejection. So his method was to sort of just sort of appear, having arranged something prior that that you really had no control over. If I had a date with a young man, there might be all of a sudden a third place set, and all of a sudden Mr. Hughes would be there, you know. And it got to be really annoying for me. It got to be where I felt manipulated. I mean, I felt like I finally said to him, if you want to take me out, why don't you ask me like a normal person? And he said, okay, do you want to go out? And I said, no. But at least he asked me, and I just hated that infringement on my choice. I wasn't being given my choice.
Did you feel trapped, given that he'd taken over your contract?
No, he hadn't taken it over. Oh, no, just for 3 pictures. Oh, no. No. No, just for 3 pictures. Experienced. He tested directors, which I've never had happen since or before. But he had several directors. And we, Duke and I, tested this director's interpretation of the scene. And Von Sternberg, Joseph von Sternberg, did this one, and it was brilliant. I mean, it was brilliant.
It was a curious choice all the same. Joseph von Sternberg had been out of work in Hollywood for nearly a decade. He'd made his name in Europe in the late 20s with a series of powerful and stylized melodramas, and he'd manufactured the screen image of Marlene Dietrich.
I had not ever known a sort of dictatorial approach. I just had never met anyone who had this Prussian kind of attitude. He truly felt that he was Svengali. And you could see how he must have handled Marlena and the stars he worked with at that time.
He was very stylized and European in his approach to pictures.
He wanted you to be like Marlene Dietrich.
Well, that was his image, you know, and he'd go to Mitch and say things like, what are we going to do with this stupid girl, you know, and Mitch would look at him and...
Hi.
Hey.
How'd you do?
I don't know you.
Did you catch my act? I didn't exactly fracture the people, did I?
Oh, I say you were doing all right for yourself.
How about a lift? Hop in.
Now, what would Mr. Haller say?
Look, I'll choose my own friends, if you don't mind.
Hughes continued in his tireless quest for female stars. His next quarry was an English actress who'd played Ophelia to Olivier's Hamlet in 1948. She'd made a series of successful pictures under contract to J. Arthur Rank. And when she arrived in Hollywood, she seemed set for international stardom.
I came over to get married to Stewart Granger. And I woke up one morning and I'd suddenly found that I had been sold by J. Arthur Rank to Howard Hughes. At the time, I didn't sort of think too much about it, and I thought, oh, lovely, I can stay here now. I'm married. And that's the way I ended up. I made 4 pictures at RKO with Mr. Hughes. On the first movie I made, I think it was Androcles and the Lion. he would send drawings of how he wanted my mouth to look. Very sort of luscious lips, which I kind of resented. He'd also do the hair style, and I got so angry, stupidly. I got so mad, I got a pair of scissors and just whacked the front of my hair off. So they had to cut it very, very short, which is absolutely what he didn't want.
So this tall, lanky fella comes, and Elizabeth Taylor is engaged to my best friend, Michael Wilding, and they're staying with us because they haven't got a house yet, they haven't got married, so they're living in sin with us, which is delicious. And Elizabeth Taylor and Gene Simmons, the two of them, are endowed in places that Howard Hughes likes. You know, they're very buxom ladies. And they're sitting on the couch, and Michael Wilding is sitting over here, and Howard, this very tall Texan, who kind of deaf, he's sort of trying to look down the front of their dresses, you see, and we're giggling and saying, Howard, which one would you like? And he says, well, God damn it, Jim, I can't make up my mind. He said, well, you're going to have either of them. And we think we're playing with a rather nice sort of simple fella. And we're teasing a cobra. This is a cobra.
If he wanted to talk to me, I would have to meet him and we'd sit in a car and talk. I don't know whether he thought he might be, taped or something. That was very strange. But I kind of found it rather exciting in a way. I thought, secret stuff.
I suddenly realized that Howard Hughes, instead of wanting this lovely actress to make films for RKO, just wanted to screw her. It becomes such a thing that I say to Gene one night, this guy is going to ruin our life, ruin our marriage. We've got to kill him. I got it worked out. He's dying to see you alone, right? And I'm sure we're being watched. So I'm going to leave, but I'm going to come back, and I'm going to come in the back way. You're going to call Howard. I said, now you take him. We had a wonderful house with a terrace, and there was a sheer drop. If you went off the terrace, you'd go down very fast to rocks below. I said, you get Howard, mix him a drink, take him out on the terrace, and you scream. And I will come out, and I'll knock that SOB over. I've got the arrow pointing where he will land, you see? And I said, you know, nobody's going to do anything about it because Howard's got a terrible reputation for women, you know? That, thinking back now, it really would have been simpler if I had killed him.
In her second picture for Howard Hughes, Gene Simmons stars with Robert Mitchum, he a hospital orderly, she a murderess. For Angel Face, Hughes hired yet another unpopular Hollywood director, Otto Preminger. In his heavily Freudian plot, Simmons has just made an unsuccessful attempt to gas her stepmother and make it look like suicide.
She's okay. She didn't even need this. The doctor gave her a sedative. Hey. Look, take it easy. I told you she's going to be fine.
Leave me alone, please.
Now, look. Come on, stop it. Stop it!
Let me alone, please.
There was a scene that Robert had to hit me. And he did it and did the usual thing that you do for movies, which is to fake it, and you do that, and it looks very good. But Otto insisted that he really hit me. Now, he did it from a long shot over the shoulder, long shot, reverse, closer over the shoulder thing, and then close up. And, you know, Robert is a very strong man, and every time he tried to pull the punch, Otto would say, do it again, hit her.
Jean couldn't help it. She started to cry. You see, it's not that she's crying, it's the eyes started to water. And Mitch, oh, God, look, he's sweet. He's very gentle, this giant. He's very gentle. This idiot. Once more, you know. So he does it once more. Bang, you see. Once more, and Mitch says, once more? Good. Bam!
Otto, insisted that I be replaced, and they sat him down and said, you don't really understand. If anyone's going to be replaced, Mr. Preminger, it's going to be you. So Otto said, couldn't we be friends? And I said, that's what I'm trying to tell you, Otto. We're all here for you.
Usually a director wants to encourage you and make you feel, you know, secure. But he absolutely, totally destroyed me. The movies that I did do at RKO, I mean, practically put my career in the toilet, so to speak. I mean, it really was... But they weren't good. They weren't good movies. Not for me, anyway.
Every one of Gene Simmons' RKO films flopped disastrously at the box office. They were mainly second-rate stories, hastily supplied from reserves in the script department. This was of little concern to Hughes, who was by now concentrating on making the big breakthrough with his most famous protege, Jane Russell.
When I get hungry, I saddle up my gear. I ride to find a juicy longhorn Texas steer. I round him up and knock him down. Time for he hits the ground and cut myself a steak right off his rear. Like any straight shooting, hard riding, law-abiding gal who came from Texas would do. When I get thirsty, I stand it for a spell. Set my hands a-working, dig myself a well. Someday I hope from the soil I'll strike water instead of oil. We're tired of drinking Texaco and Shell. Like any straight shooting, hard riding, law-abiding, plane jumping, Stetson wearing, cussing, swearing, gal who came from Texas would do.
Howard got the idea, since I had done Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, he wanted to do a musical and have it outdo that, you know. And so he's going to have me in a bikini. And nobody wore bikinis in those days, but the naughty girls in the south of France, and it was just unheard of. And I said, no, especially not when I, since I had to do a dance number. Even the camera guys were, you know, oh, no, no, my, not that, you know. So I just left, and I went to the beach, and I said, I'm going to stay here until you come up with a one-piece bathing suit. So that Michael, again, was stuck in the middle.
It was a dancing costume with great big teardrop cutouts around her diaphragm. And I want to tell you something. You see 100% more skin at the beach every day in the week than you do then. But at that time, it was condemned by the Catholic Church and the Foreign Legion and whatnot.
He can be thin, muscular, obese. That's facts, you know. Any direction will do. He can be sweet, sensitive, intelligent, a little coy, but not a boy. Now, don't get me wrong, 17 to 70 will do. It ain't the age. It's the attitude.
She definitely separates Jane Russell private with the Jane Russell that is presented on the screen.
Has to be.
She says, that's what he wants, that's what he gets.
So
but she didn't
up.
Like it.
Stand back and watch my own private chemical reaction start to work, and I'll melt all the snow in Alaska till it steams like the tropical Amazon. I'm gonna pop all the corn in Nebraska. If he's shy, it's goodbye. But if he's brave, bring him on. I'm looking for trouble. I'm gonna throw the book away. Be unpredictable from day to day. In every way I can.
This was the second time in my life that I got involved in this big hullabaloo, and all the producers banding together to fight Howard Hughes, and I'm stuck in the middle.
This is Survey of Censorship Development, dated July 1954. It's a state-by-state breakdown. Each state had different requirements. One, state of New York. Reel 12B. Eliminate following words of song together with that portion of dance accompanying words of song.
That's all I need is a man. Any type, any style, just so he's a man. Now he can be short, tall, or elongated. He can be thin.
Atlanta, first elimination, reel 2, scene 9, bathtub scene. Delete part showing portions of breasts. Second elimination, reel 2, scene 21. Interior bar, close-up Mary. Bosom in motion. Kansas City. Dance is obscene as it emphasizes lewd and indecent movements tending to stimulate impure sexual desire and lascivious thoughts. The above sequence is deleted for the following reasons. Obscene movements of body of the dancer. Her Bathyculpian posing in brief, revealing costume, accompanying lust-provoking words of her song, all deliberately sexually suggestive.
I'm looking for trouble, and I don't care what people say. It doesn't matter what the people say, what the people say, what the...
Bathyculpian, by the way, means deep-bosomed. I was forced to look it up.
What was the first time you'd been involved in that problem?
It was in The Outlaw. And it was, again, it was... I had not done anything in the picture that I wouldn't have done in real life, you know, and it was not... So it was a very big surprise and a big shock when I found out that they... somehow we had broken the seal again.
Rumor has it that The Outlaw, as shot, was a far more daring picture than the one finally released, but it is only a Hollywood rumor. The version that has come down to us seems quite innocent, in spite of the frantic condemnation that followed its original release.
No, no, you better not get up till tomorrow.
You said that yesterday.
But you're not strong enough yet.
Who says I'm not?
Billy, you mustn't. You'll hurt yourself.
Then why don't you quit wrestling with me?
You've been so sick. You're not well enough.
You're not. I have to ask you, what about the famous story of the bra? Is that a true story?
Yes, he had designed a bra. He was trying to get a seamless bra. And it was a good idea, and he was ahead of his time, as usual. But it was a contraption, you know, and it was not comfortable, and it was not wearable at the time, and I didn't want to do 103 takes on that subject, so I just wore my own bra. I could see what he was trying to do, and I put some Kleenex across the seams in the bra, and I threw his under the bed, and I went out. And that was it.
Thanks, Leo.
I did a lot of modifying of scenes with Jane Russell. Because beautiful gal she was, Howard Hughes liked her shots to be quite revealing. And so the censors would complain occasionally.
This was particularly related to her cleavage, was it?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the film editor was a lady named Ida Warren. And we'd come in the gate in the morning, and I'd see her, and she'd say, "Hey, Lynn, I got another bazoom shot for you." I said, "Oh, great, I love my work."
And how did you decide how much shadow had to go in, or who decided that?
Well, I was quite a creative artist and very sensitive in such areas. I would take a gauze and put it on front of the aperture on the printer. Just looked just in the it. Optical printer camera, looked in there, took a piece of gauze, and I could use different kinds of gauzes. We had half a dozen different grades and densities and textures of gauzes, and then a couple of pieces of scotch tape, and just laid it on the aperture, or maybe in front of the aperture to get it soft, depending on the diffusion I wanted there.
In The Outlaw, there was nothing in it that had bothered me at all. So it was quite shocking to suddenly pick up newspapers and hear over radios and hear sermons being preached from pulpits about this terrible, I was in shock. I really didn't even know what they were talking about.
It took 2 years to make The Outlaw. 2 years to pack into 2 hours more excitement and thrills than has ever been in one picture before.
And it was really the publicity campaigns that made it so supposedly terrible or shocking.
At last, the screen has dared to tell.
I could see the billboards were ridiculous, just ridiculous. They were like cartoons. And many of the times it wasn't even a picture, it was a painting. They wanted to sell a picture. That's the way they sold it.
You have ever seen. Savage love. Primitive emotions. Western of all time.
The Outlaw had been made independently by Hughes before he bought RKO, and was now brought into the company to be promoted and distributed by them. The same procedure was followed by another independently made project, Vendetta, starring Faith Demergue.
Faith Demergue was a new star that Mr. Hughes was grooming, and two studies were made of her lips, and when he saw them both, he studied them very, very carefully. And I say this with intent, decisions were not made very quickly when he would look at something visually. So he looked at it for some time and discussed it with me and then said, all right. He says, I think you'll agree with me that the upper part will be this section and the lower part will be this section. So you see that he made a notation up at the top of each drawing, okay for lower and okay for upper part of the lips. Now I had to take these back and then reconstruct the two definitions or configurations of the lip so they would correspond to the wishes that he had.
You've been waiting. I told you I couldn't get here until later. There you are.
My red rose, you never forget, do you? Say you love me, Jeff.
Honey, you know it.
It's funny. We've known each other for such a short time, and yet somehow it seems like it's been forever. I don't know. When we're not together, I feel like I'm suspended in midair with nothing down beneath except the end of the world. I love you so much, Jeff.
Faith Demergue was one of the young ladies that we were planning for stardom. And I took 6 different photographers in Hollywood. Neither one of them knew the other was shooting, and they were the top men of the different studios. And they photographed this girl as they saw her. Consequently, I took to New York a group of art that was just magnificent. So magnificent that life went for 2 pages. Look went for 2 pages. All your fan magazine just full of Faith Demergue. And I'm sorry to say that probably was the last time that these magazines ever ran a layout on a personality until they'd seen them on the screen.
I would go to the magazine editors and try to convince them that they should use this unknown girl, Faith Demergue, on their cover. And a lot of them resisted, even though the pictures were fabulous. And Howard masterminded those. Faith was one who rebelled against the whole thing, and her career didn't take off as strongly as Howard hoped it would.
Turn
trying to suffocate me.
Margo, stop it.
Please, let me go.
Stop.
Let me go. Let me go.
In spite of the advance publicity, the public didn't take to Faith Demergue. Now Hughes decided what he really needed was another Jane Greer.
Jerry Wald, when he came over to the studio, told me, for instance, that he said the most amazing thing. I mean, this man is absolutely... He said he had me come into the projection room the other night, and he had a picture of you, a thing from Out of the Past, and his favorite picture, and another girl.
I'm sorry. I didn't expect to see anybody I didn't know.
Even murder.
You can't say it was that.
Yes, come in.
And he said, well, don't you think she looks like her? And he said, yeah, well, don't you or do you? Well, not really. I didn't think so.
Help,
and then he put on another. What about this one?
What do you mean, they?
That's just a hunch.
What, Jeff?
I mean about Fisher. Did he look into you for that, too?
No, I didn't tell that. Can't you even feel sorry?
I'm the only one who won't sleep.
I'm not going to try.
And Jerry said, he's trying to find another Jane Greer.
I didn't know what to do.
He's going to show you. So he said, one girl who was Miss Somebody or Another, he had come in, and she did look something like you. Except, he tested her, but she had very long, much longer teeth. I have very small teeth, as you can see. And he said, no. The teeth are too long. He said, would you mind shortening your teeth? They can be filed down. Well, the poor girl said, no, you know, I would not be interested in that at all. And he said, so that she went by the wayside. And so he said, but he's determined to find another. And he did. He found one. Eventually. People said to me, I thought you were on the lot the other day. I said hello to this woman. She looked just like you. I said, really? He said, yes. And it was a girl called Joan Dixon.
What makes you the way you are?
What makes anybody the way they are?
You tell me.
The way they got started, maybe. I had a lot of jobs. Modeling, clerking, secretarial work. I tried hard, but it was no go.
That make a chiseler out of you? Something else.
Whenever I got a job, there was always a man who wasn't interested in my working ability.
I can understand that.
Then I met a fellow.
Another one?
Yes, from Texas. I fell in love with him, but he couldn't marry me.
None of these people were people that were, in any sense, having any kind of an affair with Howard Hughes. But I guess he had a particular thing for terribly attractive girls, and I suppose eventually he felt maybe he would. Anyway, if they were at RKO during the period that Howard was owned RKO, he wanted to be sure that they didn't get into wrong company, they didn't want to go to the wrong places, they didn't have, and I was expected to deal with that.
Many of Howard Hughes' original army of retainers still work for Hughes companies today, including his favorite poster artist, Mario Zamparelli. In 1953, Zamparelli's loyalty was rewarded with the ultimate assignment.
He asked me to meet with him, and the meeting for the first time took place in that marvelous Chevrolet of his on Sunset Boulevard. And I was sitting in the back seat of the Chevy, and Elliston was sitting in the front seat, and Mr. Hughes was at the wheel. We were near a street light. And Mr. Hughes kept turning around saying, Zampi, he said, I've got a special project for you. And he kept talking, and he found it difficult to turn around. So he said, Vince, he said, will you change seats with Zampi? So I went to the front, and he looked at me, and he said, I'm going to ask you to paint my portrait. I need my portrait painted. And I said, well, Mr. Hughes, I'd be delighted to do that. He said, well, he said, can you do it in 2 days? Now, I laughed and I slid down to the seat, almost to the floorboard of the car, and he started to laugh. He said, how about 3 days? I worked night and day for 3 days and produced the painting. That evening, I was exhausted. It was the first time that there were more than three people present. There was a squadron of about six or seven executives there. He sat in a chair, turned it around, so that the back of the chair he had straddled, and then took another chair and placed it in front of him and put his hands on the top of it and kept looking, and the room was ominous in terms of its silence. And he looked up at me and he said, I like it, Zampi. I said, thank you, Mr. Hughes. He says, I want you to do one thing for me. And I said, certainly. And then came this remark. He said, we'll start here at the ear. I would like you to take about a 32nd off here, and then go down to a 16th here. Now, he says, you understand, you start here, and you start at 32nd, and you come down, and about here you pick up a 16th. Now, he repeated that 4, 5, 6 times, as he had done many times before. And I said, I understand, Mr. Hughes. He says, I don't want anything else touched. I said, nothing else will be touched. The painting is now in Summa headquarters in Las Vegas, and a reproduction of it is by the Flying Boat, notably called the Spruce Goose, in Long Beach. I'm honored.
I put the sweat of my life into this thing. I have my reputation rolled up in it, and I have stated several times that if it's a failure, I'll probably leave this country and never come back, and I mean it.
When you met him, where did you used to go and meet him?
I met him one time. We went out and visited. We went aboard the, what now they call the Spruce Goose. That was a rather eerie experience because we wandered all through this giant airplane in the middle of the night, just the two of us. He was pointing out all the various details of it.
The first occurrence of importance was the failure of the radio immediately after leaving Los Angeles, so I was without it throughout the flight. The weather was good from beginning to end, except for about 2 hours of blind flying between Kingman and Santa Fe, New Mexico. I flew at 18,000 feet from start to finish and used oxygen.
This man whom I'd hated, dreamt about, wanted to kill, looking back, I admired him so much and for so many things. I mean, he was a genius. Mechanically, the things he had invented, the planes, he was brave, he had guts. He didn't give a damn for anybody. And I thought, I wish I could be a friend of this man, but this man didn't understand friendship. He just understood. You see, I think he was going mad then.
In July 1946, Hughes had his second and most serious plane crash while flight testing the XF-11, an experimental photographic reconnaissance aircraft. For many of those closest to him, this was the start of his most disturbing eccentricities.
It dawned on me that, yes, after the accident on Whittier Boulevard, where he crashed into the golf course there and hit a house in the way, and he almost died from that accident. I went to see him after that. He was staying at the townhouse downtown. And I went to see him. I brought him a plant and, you know, hoped he would get better. And we went to dinner. After that, we went to dinner at the Chi Chi on Hollywood Boulevard, and he called me up and said, can you come? I said, it's 11 o'clock, Howard, again, you know. No, but just be with me, watch me eat, you know. And he ate the same thing all the time, steak, peas, mashed potatoes, and a chocolate sundae. And after dinner, I said, Howard, where are you going? He said, to the men's room. I said, Howard, you're not going to make any phone calls. I'm not going to have any 20-minute, no, I'm not. I'm going to go to the men's room. But he was gone 20-some minutes, and I was furious with him. You liar, you blah, blah, you, blah, blah, you, what's the matter with your shirt? And he says, what is it? I said, your shirt, it's sopping wet. I touched it. What happened? He said, I washed it. That's what took me so long. I was in the men's room. I had to wash it. I said, you took your shirt off? It's freezing. You took your shirt off and washed it in the men's room? He said, yes, there was a little piece of chocolate sauce there. Well, I guess that's when it began, and then it just progressed and progressed and progressed and became so overwhelming that the poor man needed help and didn't get it.
Howard Hughes' mental condition was not aided by the multiple headaches he had in his last years at RKO. After fighting well-publicized court actions against Paul Jericho, the Screenwriters Guild, and Gene Simmons, he sold a majority shareholding in the studio to a Chicago-based syndicate, only to find they had links with organized crime. In the ensuing scandal, the hastily arranged formula to regain control of the shareholding involved Hughes acquiring the company outright, thus becoming the first man in history ever to wholly own a Hollywood studio. This was a dubious distinction, however, since RKO was registering huge operating losses every year and its output was the laughingstock of the industry. Early in 1955, a possible way out presented itself. General Teleradio, a subsidiary of the General Tire and Rubber Company, expressed an interest in acquiring the back catalog of RKO films for use on their television stations.
The first day we met him was, well, it wasn't day, it was night. He got down to our room about 7:30. And then we discussed the situation. He made it clear that the only way that we could ever get a hold of those films for television was to acquire the company from him. He made that clear the first night.
What sort of money were you talking about on this deal?
$25 million. That's what it was. $25 million straight. Now, what that gave us was studio properties at the RKO lot on Gower Street, plus the most important part of it were all the assets of RKO that they had produced since their start in the film business. We also started to make pictures of our own that were actually RKO radio pictures. And we made about, over the next 2 years, we made about 15 or 16 pictures, none of which were too great.
In his unexpected role as the head of a Hollywood studio, Tom O'Neill, with no experience whatsoever, cheerfully set about making some of the most forgettable films in RKO's history.
What we didn't expect to do was to make pictures that didn't make any money. They didn't lose that much, but they were still, they were not very good pictures. We had, most of them were remakes of old RKO pictures, updating them. For example, we had a picture with Ginger Rogers called Bachelor Mother, which had been very successful. So we made a remake that had Debbie Reynolds and Eddie Fisher. It's when they were married. And it was called Bundle of Joy, but it was a remake. And it was a picture that just about broke even. It didn't do very well. So that was one remake.
I suppose I shall never be wonderful. Not wonderful like them. But I've something very wonderful in me, you'll see.
I have something very wonderful in me, Mr. Hedges, you'll see.
I hope I do, Miss Lovelace.
You don't believe me, do you?
Oh, I believe your aim is fine. But you're giving yourself the testimonial dinner too soon. You've got the acceptance speech for the Oscar all memorized.
And you did have a Ginger Rogers movie, did you not, too?
We did have the first traveling sales lady, which had Carol Channing and Ginger Rogers in it.
Our corsets are woven of the sturdiest fibers, guaranteed to hold against the stress and strain of everyday living. Take, for example, hunting buffalo.
Buffalo? Hunting buffalo.
Well?
Bye-bye. The first traveling sales lady had a very good idea as a story, but they didn't develop it. It had a wonderful idea. But to do that, to come back to RKO and do that film was like coming back to a picnic you'd been on last week and come back and pick up the bones all around and see what the ants have taken from the lunch that you left. It was a very sad situation. I was very unhappy.
Even the return of Ginger Rogers could do nothing to alleviate the malaise of RKO. It seemed to stem from an almost deliberate neglect by the general teleradio management. It was an attitude that was at first a mystery to William Dozier, who had just been appointed production chief.
It was unheard of for a man who owned a company not to care at all, visibly, about what was going on. And he never at any time asked to see a picture, never asked to see a rough cut, never asked to read a script. And that used to puzzle me a lot.
Actually, well, we knew what the state of the studio was, but our whole point was that as soon as we possibly could, we were going to sell the studio. By operating it for 2 years, we actually assured ourselves that we were meeting all of the conditions of the so-called business purpose of getting the tax advantage. So that was the specific reason for maintaining it. Now, had we been able to operate it successfully, we would have then probably remained in the picture, but we weren't. We didn't do badly. We probably just about broke even, but it was enough. It wasn't enough to encourage us to stay any longer. And therefore, since our tax advantage had already been worked out, we then decided to sell the studio for whatever we could. So we sold and we were willing to take a pretty good size write down on the studio value. So we sold it to Desilu for $6 million.
Lucille Ball was currently the toast of America through the success of the I Love Lucy show, which had been devised in 1951 by her co-star and husband, Desi Arnaz.
I was surprised that he paid $6 million for it. We would have sold it to him for $1.5 million. That was very funny, to be perfectly frank with you.
I was at some meeting, and they said, we need more space. RKO is for sale. I said, for sale? We're thinking of buying RKO? Can we afford it? And they said, no. I said, well, how are we going to do it? I said, we have to borrow money. But you need more space. And then, so then when we found that RKO was a possibility, if we could borrow the money, and that was all up to Desi. I had nothing to do with that. It was like coming into a ghost town when we went back. Dusty, rusty, falling down, creaky. I remember walking around saying, I don't think I want to go in on those stages and look around. Let's wait till a brighter day and air it out a little. They wanted me to take a tour of mine. I said, I don't really need this tour. It's depressing. Someone said that when I first walked down the RKO lot, that's way back when I was a contractor, and the first day that I ever saw them, they said, that I said, someday I'll own all this, which is ridiculous. And, but when you see it there in quotes, you think, well, by God, and she did, you know. Like it was something that I always was after. It was the last thing in my mind, believe me, when I was lucky to get a job for $50 a week. It was the last thing that I ever thought of, was owning the studio.
The big radio mast stood up there on the concrete dome for 20 years. Now they have satellite dishes on the roof and TV audiences queuing up for shows like Cheers and Family Ties. They still make movies on the sound stages here, but the lot belongs to Paramount. Hollywood's biggest little major was born in 1928 and died in 1957, though its more glorious days had ceased a decade before. RKO, Radio Keith Orpheum. Once they bought a dying vaudeville circuit to show their movies. At the end, they were themselves swallowed up by television. And it's on television now that we most often see the best of them. And that's the end of our story.
Did you ever hear of Kong? Why, yes. Hi-ho, everybody. This is Rudy Valley announcing from the RKO Studios in Hollywood.
This is a lovely day to be caught in the rain.
Oh, dear, I have a feeling something horrible is going to happen.
Oh, no, David, everything's going to be all right.
Brad, I've got to know. Was Christine a communist when you knew her?
I'd never ask a lady her politics.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? This is Orson Welles.
To 142.
For $20, you want the story of my life?
I can't give you anything but...